Engineers India for the association in organizing this lecture program. As I mentioned in last lecture, on Tuesday every week, Tiruchirappalli Local Center used to organize a technical talk for the benefit of fellow engineers associated under IITLC. So this was stalled few weeks due to COVID-19 unfortunate lockdown. As the saying goes, necessity is the mother of invention. Everybody started exploring the alternate methods in organizing the events. In this regard, IEI Tamil Nadu State Center organizes the technical events using online mode. Tiruchirappalli Local Center also resumed its weekly lecture activity from last week. In this regard, we are happy to announce IEI Tamil Nadu State Center board web meeting from Cisco WebEx. I appreciate the magnanimity and the kindness by Engineer Ramadas, Chairman, IEI Tamil Nadu State Center. Since the first meeting is scheduled to our Tiruchirappalli Local Center, also we have the renowned personality Dr. Mini Saji Thomas, Director, NIT Tiruchirappalli, to inaugurate this. Also, we have inaugurate this web meeting tool from Cisco by offering an important lecture. The need of Madam, on behalf of IEI Tamil Nadu State Center and as well as Tiruchirappalli Local Center, I extend a warm welcome to you, ma'am. Thank you for gracefully accepting our invitation and delivering your talk on challenges and the contribution of engineering institutions to combat COVID-19. Our director, Dr. Mini Saji Thomas, doing several activities for the safety of the students and also engaging them in this COVID-19 sessions through online mode. So,
thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Videos as well as mic. If you have any doubts, please ask doubts at the end of session. Now I request our honorary joint secretary Dr. Shivakumaran to give a brief introduction about a speaker or speaker. Shivakumaran, sir.
Yes, sir. Greeting everybody.
Somebody else is sharing the screen.
First of all, I like to thank IE for giving me an opportunity to introduce our beloved director. Dr. Mini Saji Thomas, the director of NID Tiruchi. She was founding director of Jamia Millia and a professor in JMI. Her graduation was there from University of Kerala. Honor in the gold medal. Completed her master's from IIT Madras, gold medal, and having a very significant contribution in education with PhD from IIT Delhi, in electrical engineering. So, madam was very much instrumental in making her tenure as a director at NIT Tiruchi. Our NIT Tiruchi could see a very good performance. The overall performance of the issue in the NIR ranking, it improved from 34th to 12th and from 12th to 10th position in engineering last year. With this sustenance, recently Government of India has announced Prime Minister's Research Fellowship for the only NIT in our country. The NIT Tiruchi also set up a state-of-art facility in the Center of Excellence in Manufacturing under her dynamic leadership in the year 2018 with a cost of 190 crores in collaboration with Siemens Industry. Her enthusiasm and motivation helped to create a new office as alumni.
Hello.
These are the strict and enthusiasm laid by the director to achieve this in a very shorter span of time. So in this regard, she had several contributions to her establishment of laboratory, especially in the supervisory control and data acquisition system, and other sustenance at JMI, where Madam was a professor. And in her dynamicity and leadership, NIT is also proud to have a supercomputing facility at NIT Tiruchi shortly. So with this kind words, I request Madam to start us.
Madam, mic unmute.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, ma'am. Now it is audible.
Okay. Okay. You can see the screen?
Yes.
Okay. So, good evening, everyone. Thank you for inviting me. I'm grateful to Institute of Engineers, Tiruchirappalli Local Center, and the Chennai Center for organizing this lecture. My congratulations for moving to the online mode of lectures, and the spirit of continuing the lectures, that is commendable. Actually, last Tuesday, Dr. Kumaresan called up and said that I have to give this lecture today. So we were too busy with fixing our academic schedule, so I put some thoughts together which I thought was very essential for technical institutions. What are the challenges as well as what are the contributions of engineering institutions under the circumstances? So I would just go through the agenda. It is what is the impact of COVID-19 on the educational scenario as such, and what are the major challenges for engineering institutions and the contributions of engineering institutions, and NIT Tiruchirappalli case study. But I will not be presenting it separately. As I go through the slides, I will be discussing what we did so that we can get an idea what we are doing about it. So if you look at the impact of COVID-19 on education, you will find that if you see the International Association of Universities report, more than 1.5 billion, that is 150 crore students and youth are across the planet are affected by school and university closure due to COVID-19. So many nations are closed, as you know. So nationwide closure impact is over 90% of the world's student population. Coming to India, UGC has come out with a document. I'm sure most of you have seen it. In the present circumstances, the major concerns are as follows. This is, I'm quoting from the UGC document. First and foremost is ensuring the health, safety, and security of the students, faculty, and staff to continue the academic activities. Second is conducting the examinations and declaration of results. Third is to facilitating the students to participate in future admissions, placement process, research, and training. And fourth is charting out a plan for the next academic session. Now, moving on as to what are the major challenges faced by academic institutions in general and engineering institutions in particular. The first challenge is, can everybody mute their mics? First and foremost, impact is on the ensuring the health and safety and security of the students and faculty and staff. I will be explaining each of these points. Continuation of academic activities face to face or in digital mode. Third is conducting the examinations and timely declaration of results for outgoing students, especially for honoring the placements and higher studies. Research continuity, internships and training, admissions to the next academic session, conducting classes with COVID-19, it's a big challenge. I'll explain why. Financial viability, fees and government support to institutions, engineering institutions, infrastructure development, what will happen to faculty and staff hiring also, running of the offices, file movement, etc. Foreign student enrollment, which was a dream for most of our higher education institutions, alumni engagement and contributions, and as a fully residential institution, we have additional challenges, which I'll explain. So when it comes to ensuring health, safety and security of students, faculty and staff, first and foremost is because all education institutions, engineering institutions are here to, we are for students. Students are our first stakeholders. So our main first and foremost aim is monitoring and maintaining the physical and mental health of students. So online counseling sessions, because most of the students are back home. They are alone. Or sometimes their parents, but they're worried about the future. They're troubled a lot. So what we have done is we have engaged on online counseling, which is already there. So online counseling, we have faculty advisors for every 15 students. We are asking each faculty to call up their respective students and kind of assure them that everything is fine and that their future is taken care of, and letters and assurances from authorities. This is very important. We have to keep the students engaged. If you see at the bottom right, this is a letter I wrote to the students, assuring them, students and parents, assuring them that we'll take care of you. You don't have to worry. And basically, we have to listen to students before we take major decisions, which is very important because they are one of the major stakeholders in the academic sector. So we need to listen to the students by surveys and other means, talk to them, talk to their representatives and take decisions. Also, we have to connect with faculty and staff, because faculty and staff are also uncertain about what are the plans of the administration or what because we are not meeting them each other face to face. So we need to write letters to them. We need to have dialogues. We need to have meetings. And in NIT Trichy, what we have done is we have enabled a different meeting tools, and we are meeting regularly. In fact, last week I had meetings with all 17 of my department colleagues. So I could see them online face to face. I could discuss with them, and we could elaborate to them what are the plans we have for the semester and the next semester. So next is paying salary and scholarships on time. Government and private institutions, because we need to pay the salary on time. Government has said that it is work from home. Students are also worried about whether they'll get scholarships, especially MTech and PhD scholars. Many of them are dependent on the scholarships. Many families are in trouble, as you know. Many family members would have lost jobs or lost opportunities. Also, when students and faculty are concerned, especially women faculty or women students, there are a lot of lockdown issues related to that. Whether it is domestic helps are not available, domestic violence is on the increase. There are so many other issues related to lockdown. Essential services, goods are not available. So we have to ensure the health and safety of the students as well as faculty and staff. Residential campuses like NIT Trichy, we have additional worries maintaining essential services under lockdown in the campus, safety of the campus residents. So these are campuses safe is a notion of people in the campus. So we have to actually tell them that no, you have to follow the instructions as you are outside the campus also. So this is another major concern. Coming to the second problem concerning educational institutions or engineering institutions is continuation of academic activities in person or digital mode. As you all know, we started the lockdown around 25th March, where our semester was maybe 70% we had covered. This is when it happened. So in person, we really don't know when this will happen. There are many issues. The only way is to go digital. At NIT Trichy, we have already finished the semester classes. I'll tell you in the next slide how we created an online portal for uploading our study material. We had lot of online lectures, but there are resources at the institute level. Resources at the institute level has to be proper. For example, IT infrastructure, faculty readiness. For example, proactive faculty should be proactive. Resistance to change is always there, and they may not have all the gadgets required for online courses, or technical support is not there. So on the right, if you can see, we just initiated a e-content development training for faculty members of NIT Trichy by NITR Chennai. 11th to 15th May, it is going on. I'm very happy to say that 140 of my faculty members are very seriously attending this one-week program, so that they are equipped to go online, create e-content, and teach the next semester. Also, we will be going online for examinations of final year, which I'll come to in a short while. MOOC courses are already available. We should popularize those. The faculty readiness, at the same time, student readiness is also important. Whether they have the gadgets, laptop or mobile phones or other gadgets. Connectivity is another problem, because some of our students come from rural areas. So whether they have 2G, 3G, 4G, Wi-Fi connectivity. And also we have to create confidence in students, because a lot of students call us up and ask what is going to happen. They're scared of online exam. They're scared of the pattern, the evaluation, etc. So we have to keep the dialogue on and make the students confident, create confidence in our students. Also, library is one very essential requirement as far as MTech and PhD and finally a BTech students are concerned. So we have enabled remote access to our library resources, so that wherever they are, they can log in and make use of the resources. This is the portal we created for study material. So for each of the department, we have created a portal, and all the study material is uploaded. The students can download or check and study. On the left, you see Professor Kumaresan himself conducting an online class. So we completed all our requirements, the teaching requirements for this semester already. And we did an extensive survey of our students. as to how ready they are. Like I said, constant engagement is required. So this is for around 95% of the students, we could catch them. But I must say, this is a very conservative survey. So BTech final, all final year students, we took them into confidence. So BTech final year, 80% says they are ready for online exams and they have the connectivity, they have the gadgets. MTech final year is only project. We can even do a telephonic discussion about their or a recorded PowerPoint for their final viva. MBA final year, almost all of them are ready for online exams. MCA final year also almost all are ready. So we have taken the students into confidence already. And I think this need to be done before we take drastic decisions on the future. Now, conducting examinations and timely declaration of results for final year students. Now, this is very, very important because final year UG and PG placements are almost done in our case. I'm sure this is true with many other institutions. Completion of course is necessary for joining a job or higher studies. Generally, July, August, they are supposed to join. Till now, we have minimal cancellation of offers. So it's our duty to graduate our students. So what we have decided is we will do online examination for our students for theory courses, which is only 3 courses for final year BTech, and also for the project and the MTech project. So we have created a portal again for online tests. It is successfully tested. We'll be starting our exams from 26 May and hopefully we'll be able to declare the results for final year by the end of June. Now, how do you continue research? Research continuity, internship and training. This is another major issue with engineering institutions. Continuing the research process, for example, PhD, we have a lot of students doing PhD, their semester reviews, their synopsis submission, their thesis submission, evaluation, final viva, everything was pending for a month, but we decided to reactivate everything. We have gone completely online, including final viva. Yesterday, we conducted our first PhD Viva online, final Viva, but all reviews, synopsis, thesis submission, everything we have made it online with recording so that we don't want to hamper the research progress. However, research funding is a problem because government funding is shrinking. Industries, we need to tap the resources. I wanted to add alumni here. That's what I put a picture of. Our alumni leaders here. So industries and alumni, we need to tap these resources because there is going to be a problem with research funding. Similarly, internships for students, right now only online mode. I think this year's third year students, between third and final year, we have internships. I think internship will be only online mode as of now. Companies are giving remote training. Many of our students are doing it. We may even accept mini projects for internships. Now, this is regarding the students already with us. Now, admissions, what is going to happen to the admissions for 2021? As you know, everything is delayed as far as engineering admissions are concerned. JEE is going to be end of July. Advanced JEE will be later. State examinations also later. We need physical reporting, admission process. Everything is uncertain as of now. Now, what about the quality of students? Parents have already started calling. They are skeptical of sending students away from home. Filling of seats is a major issue. Enrollment ratio, whether every institution will be about to able to fill the seats. Another major problem I see is affordability, because there is economic slowdown. Families have lost jobs. People have, parents have lost jobs. So where whether will it be affordable to have to enroll a student in engineering education? There is going to be some issue there. We will be able to start the academic session delayed. There was a discussion in the ministry and the higher circles. Maybe this year we have to combine first and second semester, like move to a yearly system probably. CFTIs, then SFTIs, private institutions, what would be the preference of students? What about the fees we are going to charge them? So all this is, these are factors which will affect the admission process this year. A very interesting statistic, although this is not India, I hope somebody does a survey among the principals and directors of engineering institutions in India. This is a survey by the American Council of Education, survey of US university presidents. 192 presidents participated in this, 41 leading public engineering institutions and 107 leading private foreign institutions. And most pressing issues facing presidents due to COVID-19. If you see, their major concern is fall or summer enrollment. They are fearing that the enrollment will be very, very less, very, very poor. So 86% are fearing the most pressing issue as the fall of enrollment. The second issue is long-term financial viability of running the courses, sustaining an online learning environment for students, because it's there are many distractions. So sustaining the online learning environment, laying off of faculty and staff. That's another problem, because then comes mental health of students, short-term financial viability, emergency aid for students, because as you know, there are a lot of scholarships in the US universities, etc., etc. So I just wanted to show that fall in the enrollment is a major pressing issue facing the US universities. Now, conducting classes with COVID, even if admission happens first year, after admission happens, second year, third year, fourth year, the existing students, also bringing students back to campus after lockdown, we can do only in a phased manner. Also, CFTIs like NIT Trichy are residential institutions. We have students from all over India and abroad. So we can bring them only, class by class. Maybe we have to self-quarantine them for 2 weeks. Social distancing has to be maintained for at least for a few months or years. We don't know. Class size. If your class is designed for 70, we can make only maybe one third of the class sit there. So we need to have, session timetabling has to be done, parallel sessions. Laboratory sessions also, single person performing experiments. Lack of infrastructure may arise, especially with institutions with not much space. Also, making students abide by rules, norms, I think it's not going to be easy. Coming to another aspect, which is the financial viability, the fees, government support for infrastructure development, faculty, staff hiring. Tuition fees, government institutions like our institution, our internal revenue is almost completely depending upon the tuition fee paid by the students. And our tuition fee is decided by the government of India. We cannot change it. So whether we'll be charging the same fee or we have no idea. Now, government support for CFTI, central state institutions. CFTI, it's already shrinking. Already from last year onwards, infra and equipment grant, it's already a loan, Higher Education Funding Agency loan, which we have to repay. If your internal revenue is shrinking, then how do we repay the loan? First quarter of 2021, ministry has already informed that there is no capital grant for the whole year. Now, how to develop new infra with to combat with COVID social distancing? Digital content creation also we have to move online, so facilities and gadgets need to be purchased. Salaries of faculty and staff, existing faculty and staff, not right now, no salary cut, luckily. Hiring new faculty, we need to have more faculty, more classes, social distancing, staff, etc. Also, we have to maintain the scholarship to PhD and MTech students. So these are the financial implications. Running the offices, file movement. If the teaching and learning has to go on, the back-end work needs to be done. That means the administration and the department offices and all other essential services has to function. Again, we need to keep social distancing. As of now, only 1/3 staff are allowed in offices. The solution is to move to digital platforms where minimal human intervention is required. Luckily, NIT Trichy, we moved to digital file documentation system a few months back. So we use the digital documentation filing system. So once from wherever a file or a letter is initiated, it is put on the DDFS and it goes through digitally through all offices, and the final approval is given by whatever authority. So this is, I think now every institution has to move to a online office setup so that you can work from work digitally without much of human requirement, as well as for file movement is fast and recorded. We have developed a standard operating procedure for the institute during the COVID times, so that everybody has to strictly follow it, so that we can reduce the spread of the disease. I think this will be essential for all institutions to develop a standard operating procedure as to what are the precautions, how to operate each equipment, office, etc., etc. Another factor for in students and alumni engagement. We had gone in a big way to attract foreign students to India. You all may be aware of the Study in India program, but it's going to take some time for all the activities for the students to gain confidence for international travel. Finding scholarships will be difficult. Alumni are more than willing to contribute. Each institution should cash on it, the alumni resources. I'll be showing a few slides about our alumni, how they are contributing. Residential institutions, as I said earlier, have additional challenges because the students are here 24 hours. So we need to engage them in other activities after the class hours, co-extracurricular activities. With social distancing, it becomes a big problem. Sports activities, hostel safety. Also, we have campus residents, kids and elderly care, and we have to run essential services. But we have been running it successfully for the last 2 months. Only thing is you need to plan it properly, that's all. It's not impossible. So with all this, I just want to show you two slides because we did a short-term strategic plan. We have a strategic plan for 5 years, but we just, augmented it a little bit and came out with a short-term strategic plan. So this is, these are our goals. Number one is preparedness and resumption of institute activities in a phased manner. SOP, we made SOP as I discussed. We have completely moved to online meetings. DDFS, I already mentioned. Our hospital preparedness, health screening, we started from 10th March at the gate, at the main gate. We closed all our other gates. Resumption of academic activities in a phased manner. We declared early summer vacation so that our lockdown period we utilized. Then online teaching, we did, finished our syllabus. Graduating finally as students is our first priority. We have come out with academic schedule, which is opening in phased manner. Library access we have given. faculty training for online content creation and creation of facilities for online content creation and testing. Online examination, content creation, recording facility, all we already have, but we are augmenting it. Accelerating the new research initiatives, we have explained already. Keeping students mentally and physically fit, this is another activity which we are doing. Then effective financial management to minimize expenditure, optimal usage of resources, continuous monitoring and review we are doing. Safety of campus residents, including students. We have ensured that home delivery of all items, personal services, screening, COVID awareness sessions. We have created a task force to take care of the elderly and the kids. In the campus, every lane has an ambassador. So it's going very well. Finally, support to society in a big way. NIT Trichy is known for its social responsibility. So here also we are doing many social activities. We are studying the nearby villages as to what is the awareness of COVID, etc., etc. We have created a benevolent fund to help those who have lost their jobs who are serving the campus. For example, we have many shops in the campus which are out of income now. So the workers who are working in those shops, and there are many other people who are serving the campus who are without job. So we are helping them. We developed our own face shield, face mask, sanitizer, and many more activities. So these are some of the challenges and how we are planning to overcome, or partially we have overcome the challenges. But there are many still to overcome, as I explained already. But it's not impossible. We have to live with COVID for a few weeks or months. So we have to be prepared, and we have to prepare our faculty, staff, and students, and the campus residents for it. And we cannot shy away or from the stigma of COVID. We have to live with it. Now coming to little bit of contributions of engineering institutions. Engineering institutions rose to the occasion and came out with so many products to fight the COVID pandemic. I just have put here the NIT Council portal, where each of the NITs were supposed to upload projects, COVID related projects they are doing. So there are around 173 projects uploaded by different NITs, and I'm very glad that Trichy has we are doing 28 projects COVID related. Hopefully we'll succeed in some of them. Face shields we printed with 3D printing. We created around 4,000 masks distributed to everybody in the campus. Hand sanitizer we are manufacturing on our own inside the campus. As I said, we created the benevolent fund. The 3D printed face mask in our center of excellence in manufacturing, we gave 100 to the General Hospital Trichy. This is the dean receiving the face shield. Also the DSP of Thiruvarambur, they requested for around 300 face masks, so we gave that. Airport is asking us for masks. Also, our alumni all over the world has done tremendous contributions. I just want to mention a few. Admiral Srikumar Nair in the Naval Dockyard Visakhapatnam, their team has designed an innovative portable multi-feed oxygen manifold system for ventilator. Bloom Energy is owned by one of our alumni, K.R. Sridhar. So they have been fixing the broken ventilators to treat COVID-19 patients. Then a lot of social activity, Corona Kitchen being set up by 87 batch alumni. In Chennai also, lot of efforts taken. Another of our previous student, he's a professor at Georgia Tech. They have created an open air vent GT emergency ventilator. This we are teaming up with a company in Coimbatore to produce in India as well. It continues our alumni contributions. Ankit Jain is the head of Planning Food Relief Foundation of ISKCON Delhi. Some of you have read, he is serving 5 lakh cooked meals every day with the all social distancing, sanitization, everything taken care. Lot of institutions, engineering institutions are contributing to the COVID fight. I would like to conclude my talk with recommendations by the Sustainable Development Goal Education 2030 Steering Committee recommendations for COVID-19 education response. This is very important. Make inclusion and equity the guiding principle of all COVID-19 education responses to prevent educational, socioeconomic, and digital inequalities from widening, and to ensure equal opportunities for all, especially for the most vulnerable and marginalized, including refugees. So whenever we take a decision as head of the institutions or faculty or as decision makers, let us remember this. Inclusion and equity should be the guiding principle. Also the second bullet says, recognize and support the critical role that teachers play in the COVID-19 response and recovery. Ensure adequate political commitment and investment in education in the recovery phase. This is also very, very important. I hope our leadership understands this concern that political commitment and investment in education is very, very important in the recovery phase. With that, I conclude my presentation. I said earlier, COVID-19 is here for a while, so let's learn to live with it with all the precautions. As you all know, the 3 basic precautions are wear a mask, wash your hands, and keep social distancing. Thank you so much for patient listening. I hope I could convey something to all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for your wonderful presentation. Now I request audience, if you have any doubts, please ask.